They wrote down his works, his words, and his promise to return. From there, the word went forth. As technology advanced, the gospel traveled with it. It was decoded and typed. Then it was heard and seen. The gospel has moved. Today, we have more access than ever before. And every day, we draw closer to his coming, to his kingdom, to the beginning of the end.
Hey, welcome everybody. Welcome. Welcome, welcome. It's great. It's great to have you here, and we wanna give you a little bit of the rundown and some of the things that are going on today before we get started. Although that worship kind of got me started. We could be done now. We can go to heaven now. By the way, if you didn't sing with that song, you missed your chance. It could have been our last rehearsal, right? I mean, it's the Behold He conference, and it would be great if you would interrupt this conference and behold, he comes, you know? It'd be great. Well, we're excited, and we want to give you a little bit of technical background from what we're hearing and watching right now. The guys up in the booth are gathering data. We're happy to announce that as of this hour, there are people from 53 different countries viewing right now. So we want to say hi to you. It's amazing. And there are more than 32,000 that are live streaming right now with us. Over 80 churches have signed up to stream this service into their church service today. That's great. And if you have questions, we're going to have a Q&A later this afternoon together with all the presenters, the speakers today. And so there's going to be a number on the screen throughout the day, and you're going to want to write that number down or text your question to that number. And Lord willing, you know, your question will be answered. I'm sure there'll be a lot of questions. And so we encourage you to do that. And I want to make sure that all of you know that those that are speaking today, they have in the gym, which is to your left, the building next door, they have various books that they've written. They have teachings. Are they on CD or DVD? Do people do CDs and DVDs anymore? Something like this. They have product, they have things, they have, somebody said, announce the mugs. There's mugs and t-shirts, something like that for you to remember today and take part of this home with you. And so again, we are very, very delighted. And during the course of the day, I'm sure just by virtue of the fact that today's 9/11, you'll be hearing, I'm certain, I'm just guessing that throughout the messages that are presented, there'll be a chance to remember that day. I don't know about you, but I come to this day way different than I thought a month ago, how I would come to this day. I don't want to talk about it right now. But what's not on our schedule today is someone that, she doesn't even know I'm going to announce this right now, which is scary, but we're going to, a dear friend has come, and I got to tell you, I've been trying to get her to this church for a long time. She's just too busy. But she's a hero of mine, and if there was a modern day Deborah, then Michelle Bachman is that. And so Michelle is here today, and so we're gonna have her say a few things to us later on today. But just a great warrior, and we thank God for her. So let's pray. Yep, let's pray. Let's pray and we'll get going. Father, we do honestly ask of you that if there's anything in our own lives that you need to prepare us for before graduation day, then we pray that you would do that in the next few moments. Maybe we need to make amends with a broken friendship. Maybe that we need to repent of some activity. I don't know, God. You know everything about our lives inside and out. And Father, we don't want one more moment to delay our union with you. And Lord, we look around the world, and we'll hear about it all day today, how close we are. As we see end time events unfolding before us and the stage being clearly set, well then how much more are we so close to the rapture of the church? So Father, today, with the crowd that's gathered here and around the world, may everyone's theology be challenged. That's always a good thing. Is what we believe biblical? Is what we're hanging on to true? God, keep us from following the words of men and of denominations and of movements and of whatever it might be. May we be a people around the world that gets back to the Bible like never before. And may we be ready to meet you. We love you, God. It's awesome. We've never met you physically, but we can't wait to meet you because we know you so well that there's nothing in this world anymore that holds our attention. It's all done. So there's no place for us but home. And we join in with Peter. Lord, where and to whom shall we go? You alone have the words of eternal life. And we pray today that people would experience the salvation of Christ. So Lord, we give it all to you now. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Church, put your eyes to the screens if you would.
Convergence. To move toward one point or one another. To come together. For us, every moment, every second, every tick, we the bride and Christ move toward convergence.
Thank you for being here.
So
what did you think the last days would look like, huh? Did you think they'd be a picnic? No, I know you didn't. I'm not sure we thought they'd be quite like they are. Let me just make a few comments, very few, before I get going. And all our info is at olivetreeviews.org, and a lot of products, didn't bring them here, but a lot of products in our online store and other places. And let me just give you a 30-second background here. I've done 24 Understanding the Times conferences in the Minneapolis-St. Paul area, and some of you have been there. We've got some problems going on in Minneapolis-St. Paul area. It's the land of 10,000 lakes, 10,000 terrorists, 10,000 riots. So it's just a little bit difficult to do what we're doing here in Minneapolis. And Amir came up to me, this would have been 6-8 months ago, and said, why don't you let Jack take it over? And I said, well, if he's willing to, let me just go here. This is my conference in 2019. This is my security team. We had a team of 10, 15, maybe even 20 guys like this. Again, because it's not the most safest place on the planet anymore. But anyway, it's my hometown and it's my home state. And at one time it was a great state, but I haven't got much to brag about it now. But anyway, thankful for all the events that were held there and the lives that were changed, souls that were saved. and some of the gentlemen you'll be hearing today are my frequent guests. And if you haven't heard Understanding the Times Radio, I hope you'll check it out. We're on 900 stations. You can catch the program on his channel, YouTube, Rumble, Light Source, of course, our website. And we have a video version of the radio program, so you can actually see what we're talking about. And again, that would be on his channel, YouTube, Rumble, Light Source, and olivetreeviews.org. And honestly, traditional tech is going away. I think you all know that. And so we're having to come up with some alternative hosting platforms, etc. So, and started on radio 21 years ago. Despise not small beginnings, because it was a small beginning, but God opened more doors and blessed it, and I'm so thankful, particularly for the wonderful leaders that I've met over the 21 years now, featuring them as my radio guests. I want to go as quickly as I can talking about the convergence. I know we think things are falling to pieces, but they're falling into place. But honestly, the process of these things falling into place can be traumatizing. But I hope if we can see it from a biblical perspective, you won't see it as traumatizing. You'll actually be excited about some of the things that are happening, but they're not pleasant. I'm not going to sugarcoat this and tell you that I'm presenting happy talk. I don't know how to present happy talk. I mean, I know a lot of people do. I wouldn't know how. So at the same time, I don't want to just be gloom and doom, because I'm going to give you some encouragement as we move along as well. I've picked out 10 things that I'm watching that I want you to keep your eyes on as well. Let's just say they're a harbinger of his return. I could pick out 110 things that are going on. Remember the concept of last days, when things begin to happen. What is it? It's suddenly. It happens suddenly. And that's what's going on right now. It's happening so suddenly, your head spins. So I'm going to hit 10 points. We're going to spend just minutes on each of the 10 points. Each 10 point would really require probably an hour, but we're going to just take minutes. And what I'm going to start with, not necessarily in the order of importance, though I think number one is tragically huge, and that would be, as we see, as we're watching, the decline of our wonderful, wonderful country. And what's coming, quite frankly, what's coming is the New World Order. That's what's coming. There's a video online of an Australian politician. She says, hey, the New World Order is coming. You guys got to move out of the way. The New World Order is coming. So this, it's common conversation that a one world global government is on the horizon. Literally, it's right over a ridge. And I think one of the things that would convince us of that, many things, but a prominent one, and it just happened, would be the debacle in Afghanistan. We are no longer a major world player. And that was proven to the whole world by the debacle of leaving good people behind, of pulling out without proper preparation, without proper protection of good people that should have been able to leave. And quite frankly, it was such an incredible debacle. A new world is dawning, and the U.S. will no longer lead it. And that's so true. You have to wonder, quite frankly, if it was deliberate. And I think it was. I think it was deliberate. And if Michelle shares anything when she shares a few minutes today, I mean, she may back that up. But I think this was deliberate. I think everything that has transpired concerning the Afghanistan debacle was deliberate. So I don't believe America is coming back. I believe Jesus is coming back. Yeah. After Kabul, hard questions about American global leadership. It's so obvious. So a lot of people, and you know them, they're in your life, and they can't let go. 1 Corinthians 7, for the present form of this world is passing away. And that is so, so obvious. It is passing away. And aren't you thankful that for some reason God has allowed you to have eyes to see what's happening? When you stop and think how many do not get it, you've got them in your life, and you try to tell them, and all you get is a glazed stare because, or anger, because they're not with you, because they can't have that eternal perspective. So what is going to be rising? And what's going to be rising would be point number two, would be the rush to global government. And that rush to global government, the New World Order, is it's sort of all, in essence, wrapped up in what's called the World Economic Forum. Now, Mr. Schwab here, Klaus Schwab, he says the pandemic, okay, we're going to talk about that, the pandemic represents a rare but narrow window of opportunity to reflect, reimagine, and reset our world. Here's what I think. I think their great reset is the tribulation. And they are meeting early in the new year, and they're going to put their final touches on the reset. So when does it launch? We don't know. I would say soon. I do not believe the church will see the official formal reset. I think we'll be in heaven. Now that's just my hunch. Just my hunch. I think this will be a form of global communism or global socialism, probably communism at the barrel of a gun. And I think that ultimately the Antichrist will lead it. But what does the Bible say? Revelation 7, and it was given unto him to make war with the saints and overcome them, and authority was given to him, the Antichrist, over every tribe, people, language, nation, all who live, that's not just a few, it's all who live on the earth will worship him, everyone whose name has not been written since the foundation of the world. Now, talking about the saints, the saints are those who come to faith in the tribulation. That's not the church. People see that. Well, there you see, don't you see the church is in the tribulation? Sorry, church is not in the tribulation. Now, here's the thing is they want, they're suggesting you're going to own nothing, and by the way, it's a group of global elites. It's the Bill Gates of this world, the other power players of this world, and their slogan is, "You'll own nothing and be happy." Well, is that not global Marxism? I mean, the Antichrist will not allow us to own anything, but. But we'll be happy. I'm going to let them talk about it in their own words. There's a little one-minute clip here. Doesn't that sound like paradise? No. Paradise lost. But here's the thing. This bunch had to have a crisis. They thought global warming in the last 20 years, 30 years would be the crisis. Well, a lot of people didn't buy into that. But what did they buy into? They bought into a global pandemic from which 99.9% of people survive. Nonetheless, this is what the World Economic Forum and the global movers and shakers pushed to get people to trust them, look to them for global leadership. Globalists look to exploit coronavirus. So somehow, I'm not saying they caused it, we don't know. I mean, we don't know. I think it came from a lab in China. I think that's obvious. But how did the globalists tap into it? Well, I think that's probably obvious too, with the shady characters running around. We won't talk about Dr. Fauci today, but I'm going to try to resist. I mean, is he shady or not? I mean, goodness. So here's the thing. So they got their crisis. They got their crisis, and oh, how they have exploited that crisis. So point number three then would be this government overreach, third thing, herald of his coming, harbinger of his return, the third thing that's the shaking point, the breaking point of what's happening today to make our world like it's never been before. And again, that fear-based society. There's nothing more effective than fear. Nothing. Nothing. And if it's fear about your physical health, well, there's certainly reasons to be concerned, not putting that down at all. Nobody wants to get sick, particularly seriously sick. But the new religion of fear says safety is more important than truth or liberty, and that's exactly what's happened in the last year and a half to almost going on 2 years. Fear-based society, again, what a crisis that they would not let go to waste. So if we can get the mindset of trust the government, be sure to trust the government, then eventually we trust, not you and me, we trust the Antichrist, because he will be ultimate government. Now, we've got some things going on. And again, FBI urges American citizens to turn in their family members and peers. Again, COVID door knockers, they're going door to door with a needle? Are you kidding me? I mean, you know, next it's show me your papers. Almost feel next it's where's the Warsaw Ghetto? And I'm not trying to compare this necessarily to the Holocaust, but I'm saying that the mindset is totally, completely off the chart crazy. Vaccine passports, are you kidding me? Even famous leftist Naomi Wolf, our ardent leftist activist, has said, stop this madness. Stop these passports. Stop these mandates. If a leftist is saying that, some have their eyes open and some can see this is a totalitarian takeover. How did you like being scolded by our president the other day? Yeah. So here's my thought is, again, the reset, again, this overstep of the government is tribulation-esque. It's a word I made up. It's tribulation-esque. It's setting the stage for what's coming, and we need to see it as exactly that. Again, global warming did not work, a pandemic did, and the message is trust what the government has to say. If you'll trust the government, you'll stay well. That's the message that's going on. All right, just a couple more pictures here. HHS Secretary of the U.S., and we got a lot of the countries watching, but he says it's absolutely the government's business to know which Americans are not vaccinated. Really? No, they might have done that in Nazi Germany, but this is America. Vaccine mandates are lawful? No, they aren't. Our Constitution doesn't allow it. I'm sorry, you're violating the Constitution, Mr. Democrat Party. You are. You're violating our Constitution. And Australia, if we're watching, look, we're praying for you, okay, Australia? You're virtually under lockdown. You're virtually under siege. The military is rolling into parts of Australia. They've lost their freedom. There's a video out there of an Australian leader. If you want to take a drink, you take it with your mask on. Well, how insane is that? Okay, up is down, black is white, good is evil, evil is good. So they've lost their minds, and it's part of the plan. It didn't just accidentally happen. It's part of the end time scheme, if I can say that. Point number four, just spend a minute here, and that would be this creation that is groaning. And that's hard to watch, and it quite frankly breaks my heart. But I think the thing that's been so obvious to me here in the last, well, probably 20 years or so, is that the aberrations that are birth pangs, that are end time birth pangs, are all blamed on man. Man caused whatever, global warming, man caused, you name it. And it's not coming from man, folks. It's coming from God, okay? And some of the weather information, this is a headline, frequency and intensity of extreme weather surprises even climate scientists. This is apocalyptic, right out of the Bible. Frequency and intensity is getting worse. Apparently, the summer of 2021 was the hottest summer ever recorded. I don't have any issue believing that. I don't believe it's propaganda. I'm sure it's true. But we caused that? Are you kidding me? We have the power to cause the hottest summer in the history of mankind, or at least since keeping records? Hardly. So man cannot destroy the planet. There are 50 Bible verses that say God is in control of the weather. Hello? This is not rocket science, that God is in control of the weather. So when you get an earth-based type worship system, which is what we have, is Romans 8. We've got the Romans 8, and the earth is filled with literal earth worshipers, and we can change this by our behavior. No, we can't. Again, we do not have the ability to destroy the planet. I'm sorry. In Germany over the summer, Angela Merkel said the German language can barely describe, this was flooding, the devastation. So it's always record-setting. And that isn't just propaganda, it's true. It's always record-setting. Because the Bible says the intensity and the frequency as these birth pangs that are announcing the herald of his coming, harbinger of his return, they're going to get more strong and, quite frankly, just plain more brutal. Now, good news here is we have some attending today from the Tahoe area, Lake Tahoe, and the firemen saved her neighborhood, thank God, in the Caldor fires. It was a huge issue, huge fire. And they're able to be here today. They didn't know if they would. They didn't know if their whole community might go up in flames, and other communities in that area did. Okay, move on here to point number five. So, lawlessness. The rise of the spirit of Antichrist. Okay, I've already told you I come from the land of 10,000 lakes and terrorists, and the George Floyd incident that kicked everything off May of 2020, 20 minutes from my office in the Minneapolis area, and you talk about lawlessness. Actually, this scene right here is from Minneapolis in spring of 2020. And the Bible says the lawless one whose rise to power will be in accordance with how Satan works. And now imagine what I've already talked about post-rapture. Imagine those birth pangs post-rapture. You can read about it in the book of Revelation. Imagine this lawlessness post-rapture. Because the church is putting a lid on the violence right now, on this lawlessness. The church puts a lid on it. Imagine when we are gone. And again, talking about lawlessness, what is coming out of Washington, D.C.? Complete lawlessness. It's coming out of Washington, D.C. They care less what constitutional principles they break. They could so care less because they are on a march to power. And they don't care. Nothing is going to stop this current. You know, we're focused a little bit today on what radical Islam can do. And we were talking earlier this morning. The new left is just as dangerous as radical Islam. It is. The new left. Because they're out of control. They're drunk with power. But again, my hometown in Minneapolis, part of Minneapolis, 5 miles, not 5 blocks, 5 miles is burned to the ground and will never come back. And that's just the beginning, folks. That's just the beginning. Again, we've got a man of lawlessness coming, and because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold, Matthew 24. Now, much of what we're talking today fully blossoms in the tribulation. I get that. But we are seeing, and Ed Heinzen and I just talked about this, and by the way, he's speaking here tomorrow, 3 services, Dr. Ed Heinzen. And we talked about it on my radio program, that the tribulation events are casting a shadow on the church age. So whereas they blossom in the church age, the lawlessness, the creation groaning, they are casting that shadow on our age. You can't ignore it. It's a warning. It's God trying to wake up the church, to shake up the church, so that the church will look up. And it would be helpful if some more pulpits were actually telling their people to look up. So the man of lawlessness, and I talked about this on air with, I believe, Mark Hitchcock and Ron Rhodes, the man of lawlessness, we believe the devil has always had someone ready to go. Always, every generation, because the devil himself doesn't know when he can certainly see the important signs. He saw the rebirth of Israel, and that obviously made a connection. Things began to speed up. So he has had someone waiting in the wings at all times, I fully believe. Okay, let's move on to point number 6. Things that would be a harbinger of his return. Again, none of these necessarily pleasant to consider. All of them kind of on overdrive, so to speak. We could have talked about them 10 years ago, sure. But not to the degree things are happening now. The intensity of all of these things. And then you've got this kooky rise of this Romans 1 mentality of reprobate mind and delusional thinking. If there's one word you take home this weekend, may it be delusion. Because the whole world and much of the church is lost in delusion. They're thinking in a delusional way. Let's just unpack Romans 1 for a minute. The couple of verses in Romans 1, that Romans 1 culture, and that's what we have now, it's going to get worse. Hearts are darkened. They thought they were wise, but they became fools. Again, what we have in Washington, some Keystone Cops, that's got to be the conclusion. It makes no sense, and their thinking makes no sense, because the 4 most scary words in the Bible, God gave them over. They hate him. That's why they pass these insane laws that keep him out of everything. They hate him. So he has turned them over to a debased, reprobate mind. Up is down, black is white. Evil is good, good is evil. And they were filled with unrighteousness. And then they produce things like this kind of thinking. Just a few more points here. So, again, 58 gender options and Facebook and BBC films teach children of 100 genders or more. And, you know, there was a time, it's called the days of Noah, when God said enough, and he looked at the aberration during the days of Noah. Hey, there were only 8 righteous people in the days of Noah. And there were likely billions of people on earth who somehow got their thinking polluted. And he's looking at things today, drag queen story hour, you name it, and he's saying to himself, you know what, enough's enough. I'm taking my church out of here. so we don't have to see this any longer. And I believe, honestly, any day, again, this transgender insanity, I'm calling it what it is. I know a certain political party wants to celebrate this, but this is just one more reason why God is going to say, as he did in Noah's time, enough is enough, I've seen enough, I've had enough, I've given man the will to choose what he wants to do by way of behavior and lifestyle choice, and this is what you want to celebrate, then as I provided the ark for Noah, I am providing the rapture for the church. And I do believe, again, that is imminent. He will say eventually, enough, enough, enough is enough. Let me just spend a couple of minutes here, and I'm going to play a couple of videos for you. This technology and this rise of artificial intelligence, let's be honest, there's got to be Mark of the Beast technology. Quite frankly, you have it in your home. You probably have it in your back pocket or in your purse. It's everywhere. I mean, it's sophisticated technology. It gets the gospel around the world in a click of a mouse. Praise the Lord for that. But the Antichrist empire has to be run in a sophisticated way by something, and it will be this new AI, artificial intelligence, sophisticated technology where we're being monitored 24/7. And I want to introduce you, and some of you may already know of this, and just spend this just a little 1 minute video, and that's the giant. Yeah, somebody caught it down here. The giant is very suspicious. I am not being sensational. I don't like sensationalism, but I cannot help. You can't miss this. It could be. I'm not saying there's Antichrist significance to it. There could be. The Antichrist is going to have an image of himself all over the world. And now the giant has come along in the last year, this current year. It's visiting cities all over the world. And it's going to take on the image of anything, anybody, you musicians, actors, politicians. Here we go.
People of the world, welcome to the giant. The visitor attraction for the 21st century. The world's tallest moving sculpture. It speaks and sings.
Hi, pleased to meet you.
The world's largest selfie. Visitors are scanned and instantly become a giant. An experience to share and remember for a lifetime. See the city from the shoulders of a giant. Awaken the giant in you.
Oh, really? Awaken the giant in us. Okay. Image of the beast, I don't know. It's just something, you know, with all the technology that's come along and so much of it being used for evil, not all, certainly being getting the gospel around the world, but so much could this become the image of the beast. It's just, I think the timing of it is probably pertinent, which is, came along here in, I believe, in the last couple of years, but the touring of it was supposed to be sometime during this present year. Now, this is a secular headline right here, end of the world. Rise of technology will spark the return of Jesus. And in this little clip I'm going to show you, you've got secular broadcasters who are looking at the rise of technology. These, to my knowledge, aren't believers. This isn't a Christian network here. And they're going to say, according to the little technology that they're trying to kind of feature, they're even using the term, this is Mark of the Beast. This is unbelievers talking, because technology today is so obviously sort of in an apocalyptic category.
First came the credit card swipe and then the tap, and now just a wave of the hand can process a payment.
So the future just keeps coming. Let's check in with
Fast.
Jason Carr in the carport. Jason, what the Mark of the Beast is going on?
At a time when Elon Musk has monkeys playing Pong with their brains, scientists are growing half-monkey, half-human embryos, and UFOs are becoming a more real phenomenon, this seems on par or even a bit subdued by comparison or contrast. Amazon is rolling out palm scanners at one of its Whole Foods stores in Seattle. The technology called Amazon One allows shoppers to pay for their purchases by holding their hands above a scanner. Before you can use it, you have to give the company your credit card information and palm print. Amazon has been testing the system at its Amazon Go and Amazon Go grocery stores. The company plans to bring it to 8 Seattle area Whole Foods stores in the coming months.
Well, again, I mean, it's screaming at us. It's screaming at us. These kinds of little news stories, Jesus is screaming, hey, I'm coming soon. Do you get the picture? I mean, I'm not even making it subtle anymore. I am coming quickly. That's the theme of eschatology. Suddenly, 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 everything happens suddenly. And you talk about the last year, all these things. And obviously the coronavirus kicked it into high gear. And now these things are happening so fast. Now, I wish I didn't have to talk about point number 8, but I'll cover it real briefly here. And wolves among the flock. And I know many of you here are here today, and you are understandably frustrated with the churches in your community. I get 10 emails saying I can't find a church for every one email that says I finally found a good church. But I know they're out there. They're just very difficult to find. So the wolves among the flock. But keep it. And here's what happened. I think when they shut down spring of 2020. Some opened 6 months later. Some a year later. Some still aren't open. And the emails I began to get. Where I came back and my pastor was woke. My church was woke. Well, what does that mean? What does that mean? Because that's kind of a strange term, but it's everything is now woke, everything. But when the church and the pulpit, evangelical pulpits, went woke, what happened? What happened? A couple of things happened. Critical race theory, I talked about this 2 years ago at Barry Stagner's Proximity Conference. Critical race theory overran the Southern Baptist Convention. Not all Southern Baptists, some are pushing back against this big time. But again, this critical race theory is everything gets down to skin color. And that's what people were telling me, is suddenly they went back to their church after 6 months to a year, and the messages weren't about you must be born again. The messages were, hey, you're too white. We got to get into social justice. Social justice is just as important as that born-again message. No, it isn't. It's end-time apostasy. But how many verses? We could spend the rest of the morning reading verses talking about, again, Acts 2. I know that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves, men will arise speaking perverse things. It's called critical race theory. 2 Timothy 4, for the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. So social justice and critical, that's two things, but there's so much more. This requires really an hour-long message, and maybe someday we'll do that. And by the way, I say the church has left the building, and the people have not left the church. The church has left the building in many, many cases. Obviously, there are exceptions. You're sitting in the sanctuary of a place that is the exception. I think they just baptized 3,000 people here. Yeah. But another movement that has me terribly troubled is called the New Apostolic Reformation. And just let me spend an extra minute or two on this. It's experience over the Bible. It's new revelations that are all important, not the preaching verse by verse. It's signs and wonders over sound teaching. And by the way, I'm not suggesting that God can't do signs and wonders today. He can do anything he wants. He can heal. He healed me, or I wouldn't even be here. He healed me. That's 20 years ago. So God is in the business of doing wonders, not putting that down. But when you take it to the degree that these NAR people do, it becomes very, very troubling. when apostles and prophets become the authority, and no one wants to hear, well, they don't want to hear about the rapture. As a matter of fact, there is no rapture, because they're going to bring, these folks are going to bring heaven to earth. They've been doing that now for several decades. And how's that working out, bringing heaven to earth? How's it working out that we have a paradise here on? We have hell on earth, I'm sorry. You look at parts of the world, and we don't know what's coming to America. We could have some very troubled times. We've got them, but we could have much more troubled times. What we don't know is we know God spares the church from his wrath of the tribulation. He doesn't necessarily spare the church from man's wrath and Satan's wrath. You see what's happening in other parts of the world. But this bringing heaven to earth is nuttiness. It's all I can say. And the one who's the primary pusher of it, this Bill Johnson, this dominionism, kingdom now theology, this is his quote, "What's the will of God on earth as it is in heaven?" Okay, whatever's in heaven, the glory, the perfection can be brought to earth. If it exists there, it is supposed to exist here. Well, that is taking some scripture and absolutely butchering it. Let's just read a couple of verses here. "But the Spirit explicitly says that in the latter times, some will fall from the faith, paying attention to deceitful spirits, teaching of demons." We'll stop there. We've got the teaching of demons going on today. And it's almost hard to find a church that isn't pushing some kind of demonic theology. And I'm so thankful for those remnant churches that are, well, they're out there for remnant believers. And remnant believers are those that get it, that understand the times, that are watchmen on the wall, that are trying to make a difference in whatever time we have left. I'm more than confident that 99% of you would call yourself a remnant believer. And my hunch is many of you are frustrated with whatever church you've been a part of or are a part of. And that's not to say there aren't some good churches. There are solid churches. It's just we would love to be able to say that, you know, alphabetical list of where to find them in what city. We can't help you because too few and too far between. Let's just move on here to my point number 9. And that is this new hatred of Christians, conservatives, Jews, the marginalization, so that if you're a Christian, 2 Timothy 3:12, all who desire to live godly lives in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Now, here's what I heard from Mr. Biden a couple of days ago. And by the way, don't believe a man can become a woman. Prepare to be labeled an extremist. This is a picture from the Department of Homeland Security. Potential terror threats. You are on a list if you oppose certain COVID measures, including vaccines. You are on a list. If you don't like the results of the election monkey business from 2020, you are on a list. You are being watched. Here's what I heard the other day from Mr. Biden, and again, this says it in this headline, "Christian evangelicals are America's Taliban." I heard more praise from Mr. Biden for the Taliban than for you and me the other day. Yeah. They can be trusted, he said. We can do business with the Taliban. Are you kidding? You talk about debased. You talk about upside down thinking. You talk about Looney Tunes type of reasoning. And we're hearing that with just about every press conference. We're hearing that. You can trust the Taliban. We can do business with the Taliban. We can't do business with people like you and me. This is this Joy Reid. She says, "A true cautionary tale for the U.S., which has our own far religious right, dreaming of a theocracy that would impose a particular brand of Christianity, drive women from the workplace and solely into childhood, childbirth, etc." Well, you bet. I'm waiting for a theocracy. I'm waiting for the millennium. I'm happy to say I'm waiting for King Jesus to sit on the throne in Jerusalem, because nothing's going to work until that happens. Nothing is going to work. And now I find there's a new subcategory of people, the persecuted, and that would be those who choose, for whatever reason, they have natural immunity, whatever, to not have a vaccine. We are now, they're coming up with the Warsaw Ghetto. I mean, it's truly terrifying in the natural, and whoever would have thought. But we go back to the World Economic Forum. We go back to the World Economic Forum, and if you can scare people sufficiently, scare them about the virus, you'll get them, you'll have them in the palm of your hand, and you can convince them to do anything the government says. And the New World Order and the Antichrist will then take over, and we'll be able to manipulate them in a brilliant, brilliant way. Again, it says in John 15, if you were of the world would love you as its own, but because you are not of the world, and folks, you're not, I chose you out of the world. Because of this, the world hates you. And do understand this, the world does hate you. Amen. That's why you need each other, okay? You need each other. And you need to be in some kind of a fellowship. Online only is not going to do it. You supplement all you want online, but you need to be somewhere where there's fellowship. You need to be encouraging, Hebrews 10, encouraging one another. And all the more as you say see the day drawing near, because as you see the day drawing near, which it is, society is going to decline, and then collapse. So you need to be, well, encouraging one another. For persecution of Jews, anti-Semitic TikTok hate up by 912%. Hatred of Christians, conservatives, and Jews. We are the new Taliban. And anti-Semitism now has an academic mandate. So those are nine things that I see happening kind of just with lightning fast speed. Again, key to the end time, suddenly. It happens suddenly. Behold, I come quickly. Everything suddenly. It started out slow. Who knows, 50 years ago maybe? Probably at the birth of Israel, 1948. So that's some 73 years ago. And then everything went on overdrive, particularly starting perhaps some 40 to 50 years ago. Everything went on overdrive. So my last point here of things that are all falling into place. They're falling into place. Again, not falling to pieces, but falling into place. All lining up perfectly. Again, we could look at 110 things, and so I try to narrow them down and keep them simple so you can just remember some bullet points. And my understanding, and by the way, is we'll have DVDs of this event, and I'm sure Calvary Chapel has them as well. So if you want to get them, they won't be ready until they're edited, but get a hold of them. You can go to my website and check out what they have here at Calvary Chapel. It would be Mideast instability. Now, again, I'm going back to what happened here summer of 2021. And I think some people think Afghanistan, some people there have a 7th century mindset. Well, the terrorists have a 7th century mindset. But thanks to America, we brought this country into the modern times, not the Stone Age. So it's a country that, my goodness, how we invested in this country in a very positive way, plus we invested the lives and limbs of a lot of soldiers. So how does it play out in the Bible? And I think that's what I want to emphasize here. And we know that there's coming this Gog-Magog war. And for those of you who can see the detail on this map, you'll see in sort of light green Magog, Gog from the land of Magog. We've got Rosh, and that's Russia, and we've got some Persia, that's Iran. And we've got Put, which are some North African countries. And Turkey is going to play a major role, but this Magog. Magog would be the stands. Afghanistan, Tajikistan, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, that's Magog. That's the useful idiots for the Russians. The Russians will have the stand countries be the soldiers to invade Israel, in the mountains of Israel. And now we've got them all lined up. We didn't have it. You think that would happen with U.S. troops there? never. But now it's gone back again. The terrorists are 7th century mentality, but the 7th century mentality has the finest weaponry on the planet. $85 billion in the finest, most sophisticated. Oh, what does Ezekiel 38 say about that? And 39? Weapons. The weapons that are going to be a part of this Russian invasion. Why? The Bible talks about the weapons on the mountains. As a matter of fact, the Israelis are going to be burning them for 7 years, which makes the timing of Gog Magog come into question, and maybe we can even talk about that in the Q&A. That means, really, Gog Magog could happen tomorrow. And if it does, oh my goodness, get your rapture robe dry cleaned, because there's no time left. No time left. Yeah. Even the Taliban were shocked at how easy it was to take this over. So the world was completely destabilized by this nation that hardly was a nation until America came along 20 years ago. America gave them the cell towers. So, I mean, until America got involved, it was a backward, no question, it was a backwards nation. It's not now, particularly with that weaponry. So this is just a little aside here. This is the flag that flew on at the Kabul embassy. Is this ultimate lunacy or not? This is leftist lunacy on display. You're looking at leftist lunacy. They fly the flag of the homosexual movement in a hardcore Islamic country. Any wonder some of these Muslims went insane when they saw something like this at the U.S. Embassy in Kabul. So what else? Other biblical significance from Afghanistan. I'll probably stop with this. This is Naftali Bennett, Prime Minister of Israel, but the quote is, former Israeli ambassador warns, fall of Afghanistan shows Israel must rely on itself. Again, Ezekiel 38:39 says that. It says, well, the nations, some nations are standing aside saying, hey, what are you guys doing? What are you invading Israel for? But they don't get involved. America doesn't get involved. I really believe, were Donald Trump president and this war were to happen, he wouldn't stand by and do nothing. I don't believe he would. But in his absence, we have an administration that's, well, happy to let Israel go up in flames. Happy to. Might even try to light the fuse, because the left now are haters. There was a time when some of the left in Washington stood by Israel. Not anymore. Not anymore. Those days are long, long gone, because a certain political party is practicing how they're going to welcome the Antichrist. They're practicing on a daily basis. Now, I want to do one more thing. I want to just give some Bible verses, and then I want to close with something that someone has written that I think will be encouraging and inspiring to you. Because, see, we have the ultimate good news, and that is the King is coming. Jesus is coming any day. He may come before I finish here, and some of you are saying, oh, that'd be a good idea, Lord. Come back. Cut her off, please. We got leftists watching, and they're saying, boy, I hope that Jesus she's talking about comes back and gets her out of the pulpit. Okay, Psalm 37, a few verses that I'm going to close with a little reading here. Fret not yourselves because of evildoers. Be not envious of wrongdoers, for they will soon fade like the grass and wither like the green herb. Why do the nations rage? Psalm 2, favorite passage of mine. Why do the nations rage and the people plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel, saying, let us burst their bonds apart and cast away their cords from us. He who sits in the heavens laughs. Just get a picture of that. God sitting up there laughing at these evildoers. He's doubled up in laughter at their stupidity, because they've turned their back on him and they're relying on their own perception of things. The Lord holds them in derision. We're tired of seeing evil win. It's not going to win all forever, I promise you. Then he will speak to them in his wrath It terrified them in his fury, saying, "As for me, I've set my king on Zion, my holy hill." Jesus ruling from Jerusalem. Proverbs 10, "The way of the Lord is a stronghold to the upright, but ruin to the workers of iniquity." Ruin is coming to the workers of evil. Ruin is coming to the political parties that celebrate slaughtering babies and transgender issues, okay? Proverbs 14, "The house of the wicked will be destroyed, but the tent of the upright will flourish." You will flourish. You will flourish. Eventually, you will. And then let's focus on this, and with this, and then I want to close with a real short thing I'm going to read. Philippians 4, so important. "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your gentle spirit be known to all people." Please do that even today here. "The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and pleading with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if anything worthy of praise, think on these things, and the peace of God will be with you. It's the only way the peace is going to be with you, is to think on those things and to think on his, and I'm going to read it, it's going to take me about 1.5 to 2 minutes. A dear supporter in Minneapolis, her name is Sandy, wrote this for me. I read this at a conference, I believe in 2015, and then it got lost, and I found it, so I'm going to read it to close here. It's called "I'm Taking a Trip." You'll love it, because you're going on this trip, all right? And she says, "I'm taking a trip to a foreign country, a country I've never seen it before. This will be much different than previous trips. I won't need to pack any glasses, no medication. My passport has been purchased and authorized with a great price. The tour guides on this secure flight will be courteous and swift, and I will pass through security with a breeze." And she says, "I guess this is a round trip, and there will be a layover celebration before I will be returning. And I'll be returning with an enormous tour group made up of many horse riding folks." "There's still room on this flight, and I hope you will be coming, but you need to hurry, as standby is filling up fast. The red eye, too, it's time is running out." And all folks, time is running out. It is so running out. "Be ready to depart in an instant and keep watch on the overhead screen, because you do not know what time or what gate we are going to depart from. A new name will be given to me in this new country, so my name tag will change, but you will still be able to recognize me by my beaming smile. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord." Now listen, I close almost every presentation with this slide because it's profound. This little lion cub says, look, he's just facing the whole world and it's overwhelming him. And I thought about quitting, but then I noticed who was watching. Hey, the Lion King is by his side. Well, the Lion of the Tribe of Judah is by your side. You can't quit. You can't quit. God's new world order is forming. That's the millennium, and he shall reign forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. Amen? Thank you.
The Defense Department's highest level of readiness for nuclear war is called DEFCON 1. We are warned by Jesus in the book of Matthew to be ready. Is it that time?
Who's ready to go home? I don't mean from the conference, I mean home. I feel at a bit of an advantage having been here yesterday and heard these wonderful messages. Thank you, Jan, for that incredible report on what's going on in our world. And listen, this afternoon, you're in for a pair of back-to-back home runs when Amir and Pastor Jack will be closing out the afternoon, and then finally we'll have a Q&A time together. So it's so good to see you here this morning. Jesus is coming soon. There are so many things we can talk about in a session and conference like this. We could mention the unstoppable prophetic clock and calendar that began to advance rapidly beginning on May 14th, 1948. We could talk about the fact that there is a coalition of nations gathered on the northern border of Israel, long ago prophesied, that are poised together to come down from the north with a hook in the jaw and invade Israel. And by the way, God's going to win that battle too. Listen, we're all going through a lot of stuff right now, right? But we need to remember that the Lord has never lost a battle. He's never even had a close call. He wins decisively in all that he is engaged in, as Jan so aptly reminded us a moment ago. We could talk about all the elements that make the last days perilous that Paul described in 2 Timothy chapter 3. We could talk about the fact that there is a defection from truth that is in full swing in the church today that Paul spoke of in 2 Thessalonians 2:3, and it's caused by not putting up with sound doctrine, as he mentioned in 2 Timothy 4:3. We could discuss how much today is like the days of Noah. We live in a time where violence fills the earth. We live in a time where the thoughts and intents of the heart are only evil continually. We could talk about the equalizing of all faiths and preparation for the one world religion under the satanic reign of the two beasts of Revelation 13. If we isolated any one of those subjects, our time this morning would be well spent. However, I want to focus on one particular aspect of the last day scenario that Jesus mentioned in the heart of the Olivet Discourse in Matthew 24, 44, where he said, "Therefore you also what? Be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect." Now, the interesting thing about this statement is the employment of the word expect. It's the Greek term dokeo, and it actually means, as it is translated here, expect, and the only place it's translated as that in the New Testament. Elsewhere, it's translated as think. It's translated as suppose. It's translated elsewhere as best. And in this scripture, this verse, it's preceded by the absolute negative not. So Jesus is saying, listen, I'm going to come when people are not expecting me. I'm going to come where things are, or when things are not good, when they're not at the best, and when he is not being thought of. And Jan covered the fact that the fastest growing movement of the church today, I say church very loosely, because there is are elements that are calling themselves the church, but are not the church. Are you here this morning? Yes. And we need to understand the importance of rightly dividing the word of God and teaching line upon line, precept upon precept, and a collective gathering of people using similar language doesn't necessarily indicate the church. Listen, the Bible clearly teaches that there's a rapture of the church, a catching away, a moment of a twinkling of an eye experience that we are going to be privy to, maybe even today. I'm sorry, did my mic go off or something? Maybe even today. But he said he's coming at a time where expectancy of his return is low. Now, this is the attitude of the world, but we're not going to talk about the attitude of the world. We're going to talk about those who are ready. And listen, if you're not ready, you need to be ready. Jesus didn't say get ready, he said be ready, for I am coming unexpectedly and suddenly. And if we look at our world today, people are doing what they did in Noah's day. They're buying and selling, marrying and giving in marriage, meaning they're taking a business as usual kind of attitude in a season where the signs of impending judgment are all around us. Are things getting worse and worse? There's a decline in morality and spirituality happening all around the world today. But there's good news. Well, I'm not going to tell you if you don't want to hear it. There's good news. 1 Thessalonians 5, 1-5 says, concerning the times and seasons, brethren, that tells us who the audience is, believers, you have no need that I should write to you, for you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. For when they say peace and safety, safety can be translated as prosperity or security, then sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains upon a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. Thankful for the next two words. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, so that this day should overtake you as a thief. You are all sons of light and sons of the day. We are not of the night nor of the darkness. Somebody say amen. Amen. Now, darkness is an idiom for multiple things in Scripture. It speaks of evil. It talks about ignorance. It's a descriptive term for the unregenerate. But we are not evil. Our evil was nailed to a cross. And all that we have done has been covered by the blood of Jesus. We have been made righteous in Christ. Neither are we ignorant as born-again believers. We have the mind of Christ. We are not unregenerate, for we have been made alive through Christ. And that means while the world is wallowing in unexpectedness, we are living in a state of readiness. We've been made ready by Jesus Christ. Now, I also want to say this. We don't need to be ready for the tribulation. We don't have an appointment with that, because that is a time of God's wrath. We don't even have to be ready to build an ark prior to the time of God's wrath. As a matter of fact, we're going to be lifted above the time of God's wrath, not by a ship made of wood, but a cross made of wood that Christ hung on for you and for me. But here's another piece of good news. We know the floodwaters were on the earth for a long season of time. Our translation above the wrath of God is going to happen in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. And this is what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15:51. I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep. That's an idiom for die. But we shall all be changed. How fast? How fast? In the twinkling of an eye. When? At the last trumpet, the trumpet that sounds the end of the church age. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm looking forward to my new glorified body. Aren't you? It's so bizarre. I find it to be strange that as you age, and you know, I'm 35-ish, there's probably more ish than 35, but you know, my age, you can get hurt sleeping. I mean, have you ever gotten out of bed and it's like, oh my gosh, is everything working? And you kind of have to sit on the edge of the bed and do a little test drive before you actually get out and start. Does anybody know what I'm talking about here? Yeah. Hey, our new models aren't going to be anything like that, thank the Lord. Now, this is why Jesus said, be ready. Because when he's ready, there's no time to get ready, because it's going to happen so fast. And if you're not ready, you need to get ready today. Amen? Amen. Now, the title of our session is a bit military. Well, it's not a bit military. It is a military term. And I think it's time for the church to remember, and thankfully, this church does remember, that we are not a bunch of wounded souls incapable of making our way through life. We've been healed and set free. By his stripes we are healed. We are the army of Almighty God. And our title this morning, Army of the Lord, is DEFCON 1. DEFCON 1 is our title. And DEFCON stands for Defense Readiness Condition. And the military has five levels of DEFCON 1 that are related to the likelihood of nuclear war. Now, in 1 Peter 3:15, Peter said, but sanctify the Lord God where? In your heart. Set him apart in your heart. And always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. Now, every generation needs to be ready to give a defense for their faith. We need to be able to tell the world why we have a hope that they are living without. However, there is something exclusive to a single generation that's going to experience that moment and twinkling of an eye transportation to heaven that is exclusive to that generation. And listen, we talk about the rapture. We believe the rapture is near. But I have some more good news for you this morning. If the rapture doesn't happen in our lifetime, all that means is we grow old and die and go to heaven anyway. Now, I told people, listen, I'm not worried about dying, but I do have some concerns about the method. I would just as soon go in the group plan, wouldn't you? Now, we're going to use the DEFCON readiness levels as a status indicator of the readiness or the likelihood of the rapture happening at any moment. If we use the military and combine it with some historical truths that relate to what we believe, well, we'll find this. Level 5 is the lowest state of readiness for the military. They call it normal readiness. We should always be ready for the rapture. Right? Level 4 is above normal readiness. And we reached this in 1948 when Israel became a nation once again. Level 3 is increased readiness of all forces. And we reached level 3 when the generation that saw the rebirth of the nation of Israel turned 70 years of age. Level 2 is next step readiness, meaning we are one step away from go time. And we reached level 2 when the coalition forces named in Ezekiel 38 and 39 in the war scenario there formed simultaneously with Sheba and Dedan, the Saudis and the Arab Gulf states, befriending the nation of Israel and normalizing relations with them, even though it was because of a common foe, the Iranians. Level 1 in the military is war is either imminent or it's already started. I believe we hit DEFCON 1 when the pandemic hit and the world became united like never before, fighting this unseen yet common foe, and international directives began to be issued by a small group of people, laying the foundation for one man to rise to power and rule over the world someday. Did I mention we're going to be gone for that? Yes. Yeah, thank the Lord for that too. Now, one more thing and then we'll start the message. We talk about the rapture being an imminent doctrine, meaning it has no sign to precede it, nothing necessarily has to happen before it. And yet Jesus said, no man knows the day or the hour, and that's true. Right? Yes. No man means no man. Nobody knows. Nobody knows the day or the hour. But right after he said that, he said there is a generation wherein all these things taught in the Olivet Discourse are going to happen. And right after he said no man knows the day or the hour, he said this, but in the days of Noah, or as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. Now again, Jesus stating the fact that everything in the Olivet Discourse is related to a single generation of humans on the earth. He says he comes at a time that no one knows, but here's some information about that time that no one knows the day or the hour of. It's going to be like it was in Noah's day. Is it? Well, you know, people could say, well, you know, it's been like that. The earth has always been filled with violence. There's always been wars and rumors of wars. There's always been pestilence. There's always been seismic events. All these things have always happened, ethnic tensions, and the other things he mentioned in the preamble to the Olivet Discourse in Matthew 24, 3 to 8. But the fact is, these things are happening now with Jews in Jerusalem. It's a completely different set of circumstances that we are in today. Now, here's the point. If the tribulation is a time of God's wrath and the church does not have an appointment with God's wrath, 1 Thessalonians 5:9, But we will be delivered from the time of wrath that is coming upon the whole world, Revelation 3:10. Doesn't that imply if we can see tribulation scenarios forming today, then we should know the rapture is near since it precedes the tribulation? And by the way, you know, all these arguments about, you know, is the rapture pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib, whatever kind of trib you want to throw at it and attach trib to it. Listen, the 70th week of Daniel lasts for 7 years. It's when God is dealing directly with the nation of Israel once again, and it has to be consistent with the other 69. The church is not involved in the 70th week of Daniel. We are at the marriage supper of the Lamb, getting ready to come back and rule and reign with Jesus, as Revelation 19 tells us. All right, enough of the intro. Let's get on with the message. Pray with me, please. Father, we ask now your aid this morning in giving us ears to hear what you're saying. Prepare us. I pray that if there are some who are unready, that they would be ready through faith and trust in Christ, through the teachings that they'll hear today. And Lord, we thank you most of all that you have given us your Son, who is the Word, that we might know all things necessary and pertaining to life and godliness, as well as the things related to the days in which we now live. Open our eyes and ears, we pray, to truth. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, let me first of all say the things we're going to talk about are not exclusive to America. They may manifest themselves differently in other countries around the world, but the root is the same. And our country constitutes less than 5% of the world's population, yet we are the world's only superpower, and we are the greatest nation in the history of the world. I thought there were more Americans here than that. We are the greatest nation in the history of the world, the most generous nation. So we're not going to talk about what's happening in somebody else's backyard. We're going to talk about the signs of the rapture that are happening here and why I believe America is at DEFCON 1, just like the rest of the world. Now, we have to remember, we're the church, the blood-bought saints of Jesus Christ. And he said, we are not in the dark about the days that precede the rapture. And we're going to look at three evidences, or alerts, if you will, that remind us we are indeed at DEFCON 1 in our state of rapture readiness. Now, Paul said in 2 Thessalonians 2:5 to 7, do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. It's been working hard lately. Only he who restrains will do so until what? He's taken out of the way. Now, the Greek word for lawlessness is anomia, and it means to ignore or have contempt for the law. We've been seeing any of that action lately? Listen, this cannot be in reference to the law of Moses. Hebrews 8:13 says that law has become obsolete because Jesus fulfilled it. It has to be a reference to what many see as the 10 moral concepts of God subject to human approval and acceptance. We call them commandments. They are not subject to human acceptance, right? There was a college professor who took a bumper sticker that floated around for many years that said, God said it, I believe it, that settled it. And he crossed out, I believe it, and put it on his door of his office. It said, God said it, that settles it. His students came to him and said, hey, what'd you cross that out for? He said, because it doesn't matter if you believe it or not. If God said it, that settles it. And if God said there are 10 things and other elements of them that define sin, then those are the definitions of sin. And nobody is going to exalt themselves above his throne and change what he has determined to be his laws. Now, the very fact that lawlessness is mentioned in relationship to the removal of the restrainer tells us that lawlessness is going to get worse and worse the closer we are to the rapture. Jesus would add in the Olivet Discourse in Matthew 24:12, because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. And he mentions this fact in the Olivet Discourse, and he adds to it, lawlessness abounding and growing, that a natural familial love that man has experienced and been the norm for millennia is going to turn into coldness, which leads to people turning on one another. family members betraying one another, which Jesus later mentioned in the same passage. Well, let me ask you something. Has there been a recent and radical surge of contempt for the rule of law lately?
Yes.
Has there been a breakdown of families lately?
Yes.
Even over which political party a family member supports or their position about a vaccine, is that breaking up households and families today?
Yes.
Contact tracers, people who are turning in their fellow citizens and even family members because of their status regarding a vaccine. This can only mean one thing. Our readiness for the rapture should be at DEFCON 1. You know, I told the group yesterday, man, that just needs some kind of audio to go along with it, that title DEFCON 1. And I didn't track one down. So I'm going to call on you guys to do it, because I think after you say DEFCON 1, it should go dun dun dun. Don't you? I mean, it's got to have that. DEFCON 1. Yes, yes. Now, how do we know that we are there for sure? Listen, here's our first alert that we have arrived at the highest state of readiness for the rapture, and that is moral decency has been replaced with cultural acceptability. Moral decency has been replaced with cultural acceptability, and there is nothing more cataclysmic to any given society than the absence of a universal moral standard that applies to everyone within that culture or country. And lawlessness is abounding today without question. And the majority of our country long held to the standards of the Bible to define good behavior and familial love and the other things that maybe even people who didn't go to church listened to, but they incorporated those things in their family. We live in a different America than we did when I was a young man. Listen, I can remember all the parks were empty on Sunday because everybody was in church on Sunday morning. Now many churches are empty and the parks are full on Sunday morning, and it should not be so. Amen?
Amen.
Now, we live in a time where those standards have been redefined. And the source of them, instead of God and His moral code to keep humanity functioning properly and to make our lives better, has been reassigned to individuals as to whatever they deem to be acceptable for them. In other words, we live in a time where everyone does what is right in their own eyes. Now, think about what we've been experiencing. Today, your behavior is justified if your level of perceived injustice is worthy of it. You can riot, you can burn down cities, while people in authority stand by, approve of it, and do nothing if such behavior culture deems you have a right to be that mad and destroy something that someone else has worked for their whole life. I don't know. I'm thinking about something in Ephesians 5 about being angry and not sinning. But the world wants nothing to do with that type of thinking today. And the golden rule today is not do unto others as you would have them do unto you. It's do unto others whatever you want if they disagree with you. Has the moral compass of the world changed?
Yes.
Look at this picture. The UK police roll out a rainbow-colored squad car to combat hate crime and promote the LGBT agenda. The ideological move by the UK police, the Daily Mail says, has sparked backlash even amongst the communities whom they seek to appease. Globalresearch.org says, trust the science? CDC counts sick people, or people who are sick, hospitalized, or dying within 14 days of the jab as unvaccinated. Now, NBC Nightly News on September 6th reported vaccine division is altering interpersonal dynamics, or families are breaking up over people's position on the vax. And Yahoo News ran this story. Rand Paul says scientists won't study horse deworming drug ivermectin's use as a potential COVID cure because of their hatred for Trump. Now, we know that Yahoo News is the absolute gold standard of truth-bearing. But I read that because I want you to see how they frame the headline. And what it actually says, if you read between the lines, is Rand Paul is so stupid, he thinks that doctors won't give people horsewarmer because they hate Trump. That's what they're saying. Listen, ivermectin was discovered in 1975, and the World Health Organization calls it an essential medicine for humans. It's not a horsewarmer. It is used in that capacity, but it's used to treat head lice and skin conditions like rosacea. And, you know, they're just trying to package it so it spins in a negative direction about people like you and me who believe that God is able to watch out for us. Okay, people like me who believe God is able to watch. Where'd you go? Now, whether ivermectin is actually effective against COVID is actually irrelevant to our point, because the fact is the media is spinning things in a direction they want your mind to go. Now, 2 Thessalonians 2:9 to 12 says, the coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan. In case you're wondering what that means, that's bad. With all power, signs, and what? Lying wonders, and with all unrighteous deception among those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion, that they should believe the lie, that they may all be condemned who did not believe the truth but had pleasure in unrighteousness. I think we all generally understand what delusion means. And boy, do we live in a delusional season, right? But you know what the word actually means is fraudulence. There are frauds all over the place in places of power in our world today. And we live in a growing age of delusion and fraudulence. It's an age dominated by the idea that what you feel or think is real regardless of biological and genetic truths. Think about this. To be a biological male, yet to communicate or identify as a female is the biological and genetic equivalent of being 5'4" and telling everybody you're 6'4". Now think about Danny DeVito standing next to Shaq and saying we're the same height. Wouldn't the physical evidence say otherwise? Listen, Jan had a graphic I just... where are they coming up with all these genders? You know, maybe I'm just not smart enough for that, but I'm kind of sticking with the gender list in Genesis. Male, female, end of list. But here's the thing. In our day, if you tell the 5'4 person who thinks they're 6'4 that they're really 5'4, you're a bigoted hater. And that's where we're at today. You're a bigoted hater who has a phobia against verbally challenged people. Now, listen, I got news for all of us. How you feel or what you want to be doesn't change the facts about who you are genetically and biologically. Now, if I stood up here and said, how do you guys like my afro? That would be your first cue to quit listening and call the doctor, right? But today, moral decency, logic, and facts have new units of measure, and they are personal opinion and cultural acceptability. Is the world today being programmed to promote lies as being true? Yes. Is the world today presenting delusions as fact? Yes. Is the world today rejecting moral truth, preferring pleasure in unrighteousness? Yes. Absolutely. That means the world is being groomed for the big lie of the Antichrist that takes place during the tribulation that we won't be here for. Because of what is one of the clearest evidences of the pre-tribulation rapture in Scripture, 2 Thessalonians 2:7, that he, the lawless one, cannot rise to power until he who restrains is taken out of the way. That's a reference to the Holy Spirit. Where's the Holy Spirit live right now? So if he's taken out of the way, if his restraining power through the purifying and preserving influence of the church is going to allow the lawless one to reveal himself, and that happens right at the start of the tribulation, we have to be gone before he can even be made known. That's good news this morning. Where are we on the rapture readiness scale? We're at DEFCON 1. Where's our sound effect? Some of you just clapping. Now, if that were so, wouldn't we be seeing the development of things that are going to be fulfilled ultimately during the tribulation? You know the answer is yes. And during the tribulation, we're told in Revelation 13 to 15 to 17 that he, the second beast, was granted power to give breath to the image of the first beast. The image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. He causes, next word, all, small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads. Anybody that's been vaccinated, I haven't seen anybody get a shot in their forehead. Vaccine is not the mark. Let's move on. Why can I say that? It's the mark of the beast. There's no beast. We won't be here, and he can't rise to power until we're gone. Amen?
Amen.
It is preparing the world for what he's going to do, but it's not the mark. They receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads that no one, say no one,
no one
may buy or sell except one who has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. What's his number? 666. Listen, Fox News says Biden Education Department opens civil rights investigations into five states for banning school mask mandates. The U.S. Department of Education is opening an investigation into whether prohibitions on indoor masking mandates constitute discrimination against kids with disabilities. Listen, do you see what they're saying? You know, people who are against masks that aren't really small enough or tight enough to block anything, the microbes that the virus is made of, they're completely useless in that capacity. But if you're against masks, you're against kids with disabilities. What a jerk. That's what they're saying, right? Russia Today, get this headline from Russia Today. Jesus was the first communist. It says a Russian party leader stated as Moscow slips back into authoritarianism. Goldman Sachs says 750,000 households could be evicted this year unless Congress acts. And if Congress doesn't implement a new eviction ban, 750,000 Americans' households could be evicted later this year. CNN reports, another gold standard of bastion and truth, says the January 6th committee to ask telecommunications companies to preserve the phone records of members of Congress who participated in the Stop the Steal rally. You know what all this is saying? It's saying the government wants to manage your health, the government wants to control your home, and the government wants to monitor your thoughts and how you feel. So, how do we know we're at DEFCON 1 here in America? Here's our second. Man, you guys are on it. Now, listen. The pursuit of happiness is being limited to only the politically compliant. The pursuit of happiness is being limited only to the politically compliant. Now, our Declaration of Independence says this is the unalienable right of all Americans, that we are able to pursue happiness. Now, pursuing happiness isn't necessarily a biblical concept per se, but we have to remember the people of God aren't the ones going into the tribulation. So we're not being prepared for this, but those who are unexpected of the rapture of the church are the ones who are. I'm sorry, that was worth something. Amen? We're not going into tribulation. Now, we've learned some new truths and terms in recent months. Things like identity politics. For whatever group you identify with, this is your political association determined on your perceived or real injustice that you have suffered. We've learned about shadow banning, blocking users from certain websites and media platforms without the user's knowledge. And we've learned about fact checkers who wouldn't know a fact if it hit them in the face. Listen, at the end of the Trump presidency, you know, he was talking a lot about law, the importance of law. I did a message that was broadcast on Facebook, and it was out of Galatians, and it was titled Law and Grace. and they restricted my page a year and a half ago, and it's been restricted ever since because I titled a Bible teaching message, Law and Grace, and they assumed that I was anti-liberal or whatever. So they shut us down, and they're still trying to control social media platforms yet even today. I mean, think about the audacity of these people who are banning the president of the United States from a platform because they don't agree with what he says. Now, we've seen free speech violated by banning and restricting users from social media because of their politics. We become familiar with the phrase virtue signaling. Well, that means to express your support for a cause, to try and present yourself as a caring person. Now, look at how caring this judge is in Chicago. A judge asked a mother if she got the COVID vaccine. She said no, so he revoked the custody of her son. One of the first things this lady said that she was asked online at the court is whether or not she'd been vaccinated. She said she was not, and she explained that she has had adverse reactions to the vaccine in the past and that a doctor advised her against getting the coronavirus vaccine because it poses a risk. Cook County Judge James Shapiro then made what the parents' attorneys called as an unprecedented decision. He said the mother could not see her 11-year-old son until she got the vaccine. Now, 3 days later, this was reversed, but the attempt was made. It was a shot across the bow to see how people would react and what the response would be. Now, in Daniel chapter 11, 36 to 39, we're told about a king who shall do according to his own will. He shall exalt and magnify himself above every god. He shall speak blasphemies against the God of gods and shall prosper till the wrath has been accomplished. For what has been determined shall be done. He shall regard neither the God of his fathers nor the desire of women, nor regard any god, for he shall exalt himself above them all. But in their place shall honor a god of fortresses, and a god which his fathers did not know he shall honor with gold and silver, material things, precious stones and pleasant things. Thus he shall act against the strongest fortresses with a foreign god, which he shall acknowledge and advance its glory, and he shall cause them to rule over many and divide the land for gain. Now, this one referred to as the king is the first beast of Revelation 13, who we commonly refer to as the Antichrist. He will operate independent of any authority. He will do what he wants, including magnifying his word above all religious beliefs and systems, and he's going to be successful at it for a short while. He will not regard the God of his own people, nor the desire of women. There's been a lot said about that particular phrase, but the actual more accurate translation is the one desired by women. Many commentators see this because the one desired by Jewish women was to be the mother of the Messiah, and it's simply he will not regard the one desired by women. He will not regard the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, nor his Messiah, the Mashiach ben David. Now, instead, he's going to give his strength and dominate by force, he will have his strength and dominate by force, which is the meaning of a god of fortresses. He's going to surround himself with a small group of loyalists who spread his political and religious influence around the world, the god that his ancestors did not know, which is likely Satan, who is the god of this world. Is the world headed in that direction already? Are there a collective few dictating to us all what we can and cannot do based on our politics or vaccine position? Are there people in places of power violating parental rights? Now, we're also told about this beast in Daniel 7:25. He shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and law. And then the saints shall be given into his hand for a time, times, and half a time, which is a phrase descriptive of 3.5 years. This, too, is the first beast of Revelation 13, or the Antichrist. And during the tribulation, he is going to persecute the saints. Now, the saints is not a term that is exclusive to the church. There are Old Testament saints. There are the church saints. And there are tribulation saints. Yes. And in Matthew 16, 18, we're told by Peter, or to Peter, Jesus said to Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not, what? Prevail against it. And then in Revelation 13, 7, we're told it was granted to him to make war with who? And to overcome them, and authority was given him over every tribe, tongue, and nation. Now, the Greek word translated prevail in Matthew 16, 18 means to overcome. The church cannot be overcome by the gates of Hades. So, therefore, the church cannot be present during the tribulation period. Now, those overcome during the tribulation are saints, but they're not the church. Abraham, Moses, and David are saints, right? We also know that Rahab, Ruth, and Deborah are saints, but they are not the church. Now, are laws being changed today or are violated and ignored?
Yes.
Changing times and seasons, some see as representing the Jewish feast days, which means the beast is going to forbid any religious activity except for worshiping him. Are churches being restricted today?
Yes.
Are laws being written that violate not only our rights, but the directives of God? Is there growing anti-Semitism today and a denial of Israel's right to the land that God gave them by everlasting covenant?
Yes.
It's all happening right now. What does it all mean? It means that our readiness for the rapture is at DEFCON 1.
Yes.
Now, I'm not saying it should be. I'm saying it is, whether you're ready or not. And Paul said in 2 Timothy 3, 1-5, but know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves. You can put a check by that, right?
Yeah.
Lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, which is a fruit of the Spirit, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power, and from such people, turn away. Now, this is a pretty exhaustive and conclusive checklist that ought to tell us we are deep into the last days, because all these things have been actualized in this recent season of history. But I want to focus for our last couple of minutes on this last section of Paul's prophecy about what makes the last days perilous. He mentions that people will be traitors. They'll be headstrong, and they'll be haughty. And the Greek word for traitor means to give in to the enemy. It means to be a betrayer. Headstrong means to fall forward or to fall headlong into. Haughty means inflated with self-conceit, proud or puffed up. Now, is there any particular group that comes to mind who, for the most part, but not all, thank God for men and women like Michelle Bachman,
Amen,
who have fallen headlong into betraying us and giving in to the enemy, who are inflated with self-conceit and pride? Well, I think you know where I'm going with this. Listen, the town hall reports the Pentagon really doesn't want to talk about the Americans being left behind in Kabul, bragging about the more than 122,000 individuals evacuated, including 5,400 Americans in the airlift from Kabul's airport. The Gateway Pundit says a Sacramento high school teacher was caught on undercover video bragging about indoctrinating students to become Antifa revolutionaries. He views American children as martyrs for a cause. The Floridian reports that Pelosi blocks the name of 13 service members killed from being read. A day after the U.S. officially pulled out of Afghanistan, and less than a week after a suicide bomber killed 13 U.S. service members, Representative Carlos Jimenez has tweeted that Speaker Pelosi blocked the names of those dead servicemen and women from being read on the floor of the House of Representatives. Shame on her. Now, Isaiah 3, 4, and 5, the prophet says, I will give children to be their princes, the Lord speaking, and babes shall rule over them. The people will be oppressed, everyone by another and everyone by his neighbor. The child will be insolent toward the elder and the base toward the honorable. And look how that parallels what Paul said in 2 Timothy chapter 3 and how those things overlap one another. Now, children as princes and babes ruling over them would be the consequences of Israel's rebellion against God that would eventually manifest itself in the carrying off of God's people to the Babylonian captivity. But what the phrase means is not literal. It doesn't mean that little kids are going to be your rulers, even though we do know one particular king was 8 years old. But the fact is, it means incapable and unqualified rulers will be the result of the rebellion of Jerusalem and Judah. Now, our concluding indication that we are at DEFCON 1 of rapture readiness, it may sound like I'm busting a rhyme, and it does kind of roll off the tongue, but I think you realize that it's true. You ready for this? You just say yes, because it's coming anyway. Now, listen. Here's our last indication that we need to be rapture ready like never before. Incompetent leaders are respected and protected who should be rejected and arrested. Now, I just want to say, I'm not thinking about anyone in particular because my personal policy is not to mention names, even though it feels like we're biding our time. We're waiting for someone to come all along and take our country in the right direction. Amen? Amen? I was trying to recall something else. What was it? What was it I was trying to recall? Gosh, I guess that's part of being an elder. Probably one of those sayings I'll remember when I was trying to recall, like on September 14th or something. I don't know. But listen, you might be thinking, how are incompetent leaders part of the last day's scenario? Well, let me answer with a question. Are there a rising number of people today who are calling for socialism? Yes. Communism in our country? Does socialism have a place within it for God? No. In socialism, God is replaced by the government. And Jesus said in Matthew 6:31-34, therefore do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after all these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things, but seek when? First, the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Socialism places the role of God onto the government. Therefore, socialism is sin. And this is exactly what the Antichrist is seeking to implement. Authoritarian rule, not over a country, but over the planet. And listen, we're hearing phrases like equality of outcome, which is actually equality of income. Everybody gets the same thing, no matter how hard they work, or even if they work under this system. So what's going to happen in all this mess that our world is in? Well, Isaiah 5 says, woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. Woe to men mighty at drinking wine. Woe to men valiant for mixing intoxicating drink, who justify the wicked for a what? For a bribe, and take away justice from the righteous man. Therefore, as the fire devours the stubble and the flame consumes the chaff, so their root will be as rottenness, and their blossom will ascend like dust, because they have rejected what? The law of the Lord of hosts and despise the word of the Holy One of Israel. Woes are coming on this earth. And what God is going to do to the tribulation is going to make a nuclear bomb look like a 4th of July sparkler. Things are going to happen that have never, ever happened on the earth before. Unprecedented is going to become a word used of everything that happens during that season. Things that wipe out a third of the earth's population or a quarter of the earth's population under the four horsemen of the apocalypse. An earthquake like has not been on the earth since men were on the face of the earth, are the types of things that Revelation describes are going to happen on the earth that we're going to miss. Listen, the Antichrist is going to be able to take power over a world that is crying out for change, for peace and prosperity. People who are disenfranchised because of the incompetence of people in places of power. And I cannot help but think of the parallels between our country and others with the whole scenario between Saul and David. Israel, in 1 Samuel 8, said, we want to be like other countries. We want a physical, present, visible king like other people. Well, Samuel told the people that the response of God to this request, here's the deal. King's going to take your stuff. He's going to steal your land. He's going to put your sons in his army and your daughters in his kitchens. And he's going to take your servants, he's going to take your livestock, and he's going to tax you a tenth of all that you have. And when you cry out to God because of your oppression and the king's actions, God is not going to hear you. Right. People said, okay, sounds good, we'll take it. But God had waiting in the wings a man after his own heart. It wasn't a man who was head and shoulders taller than all the rest of the Israelis, but a man who God looked upon his heart and said that this man is going to offer praises to me. He's going to glorify me. And we know that Jesus is referred to as the Son of David. And this exact scenario is going to play out during the tribulation. The world is going to get exactly what they're asking for. But the king the world was asking for is going to be replaced by the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now listen, when political correctness and cultural acceptance replace God's moral standards for humanity, when what is supposed to be protected by the government is made exclusive to a select few who are in agreement with them, and all things of God are deemed as unessential, when world rulers are incompetent and clueless, yet think they can take the place of God and assume his role, the world is at DEFCON 1. So what's going to happen next? The Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel and a trumpet of God. The dead in Christ will rise first, and we who are alive and remain will meet them in the air, being caught up. And we will always be with the Lord. This world is a mess, but heaven isn't. And we're going to be there a lot longer than we've been here. Somebody say, amen. Amen. Father, we are so grateful for your word. We thank you for speaking into our hearts truth. From your book, which is infallible, and every word on every page inspired. So we give you thanks, Lord, for the authority of your word. We believe as it presents itself to be living and powerful, and the entirety of it is true. So Lord, I pray that if there be any here who are not ready, that they are getting ready in their hearts by recognizing you are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You are humanity's Savior. We thank you for the time we've had so far. We pray your blessings on this afternoon as well. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, guys.